Lois Duncan is the award-winning writer of fiction for young adults, and her new book is Who Killed My Daughter from Delacorte Press. With us now is Robert Schwartz, the Bernalillo County, New Mexico district attorney. That's the county that houses the wonderful city of Albuquerque. What do you make of this, Bob?
Well, Larry, the police investigation is almost a mirror image of what's portrayed in Ms. Duncan's book. The police investigation tells us who did it, what happened, and how it happened. What it doesn't tell us very well is why it happened. And as a prosecutor, you learn to quit trying to understand why people are killed and just accept them.
What do you mean tells us who did it?
Well, it indicates who the individuals were that shot her, most likely. Again, how they did it and what happened.
But you can't prove it.
But we can't prove.
Who, in their opinion, most likely did it?
The two young men who were arrested for the crime.
The of Spanish origin,
yes,
who
the two
employed for hire.
No, we don't believe that. Quite frankly, knowing these guys and their background, to put it quite bluntly, I wouldn't hire these guys to mow my lawn, much less mow down a young woman in Albuquerque.
So it is termed what now? If I called up and said, where does this stand in the books, what is it?
It is an open case. It is an open investigation. It is dormant at the moment. We are hoping that another lead will pop out. That's what ultimately led me to drop the charges, because had we taken a shot of it, I was convinced. I was convinced we would have lost, and then it would have been over. We don't get a second chance in the
justice system. What couldn't you do? Put the boys at the scene?
No, we could put them at, we could put them at the scene. But here was our major problem. One, the witnesses that originally came in and put together the case for us, they started backpedaling. They became pretty much unusable. The other problem was the defense attorneys had gotten onto this Vietnamese connection. Again, what it has is a much better motive than our case.
The Vietnamese guy.
Yes, it's a good motive, but the trailhead pretty much stops there. Now, you dangle a good motive in front of a jury. I thought that would just foreclose it.
What do you want him to do, Lois?
What do I want Bob to do?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think Bob will be very open to any new information that comes in. What I'm hoping the book will do, Bob and I are both hoping will be accomplished here tonight, is that people who hear this story will be motivated to come forward with some concrete information that the police can use.
You're not angry at Bob and the police?
No, I'm not angry at Bob.
Because you feel Bob was right in not going ahead with the trial.
Oh, absolutely.
You can't try him again.
He had absolutely no choice. He did exactly the right thing. And I think the police did a very good job as far as making the arrests. I think where the police may have fallen down was that they were unwilling to accept outside help. For instance, there were a number of letters that were written in Vietnamese that were found in Kate's desk. And we offered to get those translated, and they wanted to do it themselves, and then it turned out they couldn't afford to.
Why wouldn't they do that?
Well, the letters that were given to us was originally represented that they were from Orange County, California, which was the California connection with the auto injury scam. They had postmarks from Kansas, Colorado, Texas, and dated back as far back as 84 and 85. They were also given to the defense attorneys who were working with an investigator who was fluent in Vietnamese. Had there been any dynamite in those letters, that fuse would have been lit for us by then.
The two boys who would be, for want of a better term, suspects, where are they now?
Well, one is in Albuquerque. The other was after I had to drop charges in this, I felt, to be cautious and to do the best job twice. After there was some initial problem with the case, we were able to hold them on unrelated matters. One was released on that unrelated matter and has not been seen since. I have no idea where he is. It's believed he's in Mexico. He's a Mexican national.
This happens to prosecutors frequently in their careers, and it must drive them up a wall when they believe someone to have done something and can't prove it.
Well, reality stops at the courthouse steps. That's a common occurrence.
Do you lose sleep over it?
Sure, we lose sleep over it. I mean, the worst moments a prosecutor can have is when we had to sit down with Lois, as I have done with way too many families, and explain that the system cannot give them any peace here.
What do you say when you hear that?
Well, I understand what he's saying, certainly. Larry, there were some other things, however, that led us to believe that this went further than random. For one thing, when I was paying Kate's final phone bills, I discovered several phone calls that were made to Orange County, California, out of her apartment when she was in a coma in the hospital and then had just been pronounced dead. And her boyfriend was with us at the hospital. No one should have been in her apartment. And
did they call the trace as to who they were to?
Well, the police couldn't or wouldn't find out who were they to, so I asked the investigative reporter to find out, and the calls have been made to the paralegal who set up the car wrecks.
What do you make of that, Bob?
Well, the police, Larry, in this case, the police chased every leaf in the wind, and they did follow up on those calls. There were three calls. Two of them were to a beeper number believed to be with this paralegal, and the other one was to his home. We believe that friends of Kate's boyfriend were at the apartment at that time. And that's it, very simply. That was followed. But again, don't know exactly what that tells us.
When the paralegal got these calls, he immediately changed his phone number.
Was there a psychic involvement in this case? Did you call psychics as well?
Yes, we did work with psychics
well.
Because we were desperate for information. And I was a contributing editor to Woman's Day magazine, so I was given an assignment to do an article on the top psychic detectives in the country. We're not talking gypsies and tents. These are women who work with law enforcement,
who
lecture at the FBI.
They
told us, every one of them told us exactly the same thing.
That these guys did it?
No, they told us it was a contract hit.
The psychics don't mean anything.
I'm sure they wouldn't to Bob, and we didn't even present him with it because we knew it wouldn't.
I'm not necessarily a congenital skeptic, but what can I do with it in court? And it's true, the drivetrain of a lot of what Lois is contending happened comes from the psychics, but that is of no utility to me as a prosecutor. It didn't even give us a trailhead.
If someone is, you're looking for someone who might be watching who might know what? Connect these boys with
what I would be looking for would be the link between these two sets of people, since I firmly believe there is a link.
The Vietnamese and the Latin.
I think there is a link.
You don't.
He doesn't.
No, I don't. But I'm looking for something too. What I'm looking for are two women. One we know about. Well, we know about two of them. We think that if they come forward, that they will go ahead and give us the adhesive we need to put the case together.
Were they the women that backed off initially?
One woman called up through the Crime Stoppers program, and the other woman was somebody who came to us through a mental health therapist, and we went and approached the woman. The therapist probably breached some rules of her own there in telling us about this woman. This woman denied that it happened. But I don't believe them. I think they're scared.
And you like the book?
Pardon me?
You like the book?
I do like the book.
The book is Who Killed My Daughter? The author is Lois Duncan. Robert Schwartz is the district attorney in Albuquerque. We'll come back and start to include your phone calls. Don't go away.